My name's Randy Seol, and I was born in Upland, California.
I'm from California too, but I don't know where Upland is.
Upland's by Ontario. And I've been up ever since.
Yeah. You use that joke?
No, just tonight. Just
really?
Tonight, yeah.
So, we'll start off. You started a lot long. How long has that band been around?
I joined them in 1967. They were an embryo in 1966 with a name called the Sixpence. And when I first met them, they were still called the Sixpence. Their manager found me and was interested in vocals and a lead singer for the band. Is basically how I had gotten it. They had a track recorded, which is the Incense musical track, and needed the vocals on it. They had the words written, and my thing was to go over and meet the band and show them my ideas vocally and see if it went over. And that's how I met him, you know?
That's Incense and Peppermints, of course, is probably the song that most people are familiar with by the Strawberry Alarm Clock.
Yep, it has the most sales and most airplay of any of our tunes, for sure.
But at the time, is it true? I read that you guys, perhaps not you, but some members of the band weren't happy with it. They thought it was too commercial. Is that true, or was that
really? No, the band actually really liked the instrumental track. I mean, they were very pleased with it. They didn't have any words. What I think soured them on the tune was the fact that the producer and manager brought in the other words, which they liked the words. They said, yeah, these words are cool. But in the meantime, even though they wrote all the melody lines and the music, the writers had taken all of the writers and publishing rights. Basically, the band had no royalties, only artist royalties. So with that in mind, it was enough to make them think, you know, what do you mean? We don't get any credit for writing this song? And basically, they didn't. And so they were rather irritated, to say the least. It was, I had a good job in front of me, bringing their attitude right so that they would sing the song and we would get through this. It was a real job because they were very sour, and I was to try to put it all together and help make the vocals happen, which was the last part of the song to be done. And we did it, you know, and we did it, and it went over, it came out well. I sang a lead track, and also Greg Mumford, who had just walked into the studio that day, sang a lead track. They picked his lead. I'm on most of the background parts, and the band did help in that and such, but they picked his lead, and so he wouldn't join the band, and then the manager, and then basically they asked me, you know, can we go live? You're going to sing it, okay? And I said, sure, I'll sing it. And that's how that went. And then, so I'm in the song, in the third verse, I'm on the lower harmony, but as far as the real lead, it was done by Greg Mumford. And I've just done my best to cop his intonation and, you know, in the way he sings it so that it sounds like the record. But directly involved in putting the vocals together.
That song is still enormously popular, like you were saying. What do you
think? It's a timeless tune.
What about it makes it still sound so contemporary and fresh?
Just because there's not a lot of tunes that sound like it, for one thing, we can play it now and you can't say, well, that song sounds like that, or that song sounds like that. It still has its total own sound, you know. It's a mix of major chords and minor chords together in a way that, you know, it just has a worldly sound instead of just a downright, you know, American rock and roll sound. It has almost an India or Oriental influence to it, which was different, you know, and it still is. But it's fresh. When people hear it, it's a fresh kind of sound. And
well,
so they enjoy
it. What's kind of the India influence? Or what's the little part of the song? Do you just, like, hum the part that sounds a little like Indian influence?
I think it's a combination of the chords and the bass line more than the melody. I mean, you might be able to put those three together, and then you're getting into a point where you're getting a dissonance.
Hum the part for me.
I can't think of that exact part.
See, I was thinking it's like that.
Because, you know, that that you know, that could be it. But I know that because of all the different, I mean, it has a lot of chords in it. It's not just a straight 1-4-5 rock and roll song. It's really different. And because of the intonation and the way these guys, Mark White, which did write it with Ed King, he plays keyboard like no keyboard player I know. He's totally un-cliché keyboard man. He has a fresh flavor in which I think with his chords and Ed's chords together created that dissonance and that sound, which is almost gets into a between putting two half tones together. You could almost get to where it's almost like a quarter tone, where it brings in that worldly sound, or that, you know, that kind of scale that just makes it sound that way. I can't pick that exact melody line where it happens. It's kind of throughout, in my eyes. Let me think what tunes are on here.
Do you listen to that record? Do you guys listen to your records very much? I mean, you must have to.
In fact, we're contemplating on doing that one tune, Sitting on a Star. It's one of the old ones we haven't learned. But these are the Black Butter's on this album.
Yeah.
Sit with a Guru. Yeah. So that could be one of the things that they said about, because this is a pretty neat little trilogy of tunes right here. It's really different. Oh, it is on that album. Yeah, it is on that album.
Well,
did they put Tomorrow on both albums then? No? Tomorrow's not on Wake Up, It's Tomorrow?
That's it.
Oh, it is. Dang.
Gather, you know.
Let me get him up here talking. That is Wake Up, It's Tomorrow. Okay, yeah. We did get it. Yeah, I remember now. I was in an album later. So we had both those tunes on this. Is it with the Guru? Yeah, it is. That's right, right. That was one of our. Yeah, that was a.
How do you account for how fresh this record sounds today, and that people are like raving about this record, and for good reason. It sounds very contemporary, and you know, for someone that's never heard this record before, like.
Mm-hmm.
I would imagine they heard it go, whoa, that's a fantastic record. How has it lasted this long? You know, not every record from 1969 sounds that good.
Well, thank you. I'm just remembering now more that we went from the real rootsy psychedelic when we were 16 and 17 to where we did go into more fusion and more jazzy type of things with this album. We were able to branch a lot more vibes, and I remember us doing it live in LA and stuff, and it was really a lot more complicated, and for me especially as a percussionist, and they had me playing all these different instruments and running around and stuff, and even with the sitar. We branched out with a lot of different instruments with it and stuff, but we did bring in a lot more jazz feel to the rock, which they call like a fusion now. And maybe because fusion is pretty popular, even with soft jazz and all that, that it's more accepted, or is accepted. But this was a great album for us, because we still had the reign of doing what we wanted to do. And it got, after this album, it got to where the producers and everybody was telling us what to do a lot more than this album. We still had a lot of our individual artistic, you know, say-so, which, so that could, hopefully that's part of the reason that it is as popular as it is, because that's, the new album's going to be a lot like that too. We're going to do what we want to, not what they're bringing in all the other material in and telling us to do.
I want to ask you about that next.